HarperCollins presents The Last Word by Amy Price. Read by Annie Aldington.
A dedication. This book is for my family. Without them, I would never have been a complete me. To my funny, hardworking, supportive husband, Paul, you are always in a muddle and a rush. But you have looked after me as best you could. I know my illness has been a hard road, and we have had to accept it together. You have been there with me, for me, in every meeting without fail. I, the logical one, accepting the inevitable outcome, and you, the positive one, having hope, even when the news is bleak. I adore you. Who knew we would put up with each other for over 38 years. No one thought it would last. It did, and I'm so grateful for every single second of it. To my son Daniel, Dan the man, I couldn't have wished for a more wonderful, strong-minded, thoughtful, and clever son. You've been supportive of us as a family, always there for us, but especially me. We have a special bond. You're a wonderful father to your children, and I love you with all my heart. I am so very, very proud of you and what you have achieved. I know you will continue to look after our family forever. You are the building block and the wisdom. In the months I have been ill, you have shined through, helping me like no other person. We have had many a deep conversation about how you would support me and Paul, your dad, when I'm gone. I am grateful and so lucky to have such a wonderful son. To my daughter, Kate, Katrina Doldo, you are a kind, generous, caring daughter to me, so vulnerable and fragile, and yet when I look into your eyes, I can see you understand and love me wholeheartedly. Hard work, yes, you are, but iridescent with a personality that shines through. You are always late, but you arrive with a smile on your face so magical that I forget I was supposed to tell you off. Kate, you have given me so many ups and downs in life and experiences I would never have had without you, both good and bad. Being your mum has been a total learning curve, but I've loved every moment, and I'm very proud of you, especially watching you become a wonderful mother yourself. I love you dearly. You are so misunderstood, but I understand you well. You are like a perfect peach now, at last, ready to ripen with age, beauty, and wisdom, and you will. To my baby daughter Sophie Wofie Doldo, my double. Like me, you love the simple things in life, nature, music, the sea, and driving around the countryside, together with a coffee, marvelling at nature and playing music at the same time. We cry too, emotional but happy tears. How wonderful that we can cry and laugh at the same time. Sophie, you have always been a breath of fresh air. You have spoiled me and encouraged me to enjoy and embrace the simple things in life, especially when I've felt ill and we've gone out on trips, even in Dad's in the land of the Toyota. And we have enjoyed life. You are not materialistic, but you are a Mother Earth person like me. And you won't admit it yet, but I know you will become spiritual and embrace my love of yoga. You too are a wonderful mum, and you've blossomed with motherhood. I'm so very proud of what you have achieved too, going from a hairdresser to gain a master's degree in history. How proud am I of this? You will have your own Amy's cottage one day, I promise. To my grandchildren, Junior, you are caring, and I know you love me wholeheartedly. I love your texts of encouragement and love. When I'm feeling low, they cheer me up. You will always be successful and so talented. Make your own way in life and ensure that the decisions you make are your own and not influenced by other people. Stay true to yourself. And then there is Princess, my double, Kate's double. I love the fact you have my curly hair. You text me all the time asking me how I am and what I am doing. I'm so lucky you care like you do. Princess, you will be a shining star too. You shine now, and I know you will continue to do so. You know your own mind, and you need to trust your own decisions. My little Jet, you are a little farmer and my gardener, with an angelic face and a heart full of love. You are so caring. Bunny, the mischievous one, who helps me in the garden too and loves my vegetable patch, always in trouble and headstrong. You are sharp as a razor and a mini Kate. Amelie, the amazing footballer with your large sparkling eyes. And Betsy, with your wonderful smile that illuminates your face, your wonderful singing and piano playing. You all have my curly hair and call me Nanny Big Hair. I love that. Albert, my Tom Thumb. You are my youngest little grandson with strawberry-coloured hair that's going curly to my delight and big saucer eyes. When your mum stays with us, we all snuggle up in bed with you while drinking coffee and chomping digestive biscuits. You have a gentle personality and I'm sure you will have a kind heart. Will you be a footballer? Granddad asks. No, your mum says, a polo player. I wonder what life will offer you all. I wish I could be there to find out, but it's enough now for me to imagine. Then there is Harvey. For the first 13 years of your life, I was with you and your mum constantly as we tried to understand you while juggling your hospital appointments with the school runs. We encouraged you to learn and adapt to your medication, even though we were sometimes anxious. Would you talk, walk, interact, have facial expressions? Would you be able to love and feel emotion? Would you be able to feel and say, I love you, Mum? Well, as I write this, you are 20 years old, and that is an achievement in itself. I cannot tell you how much I've learned from you, Harvey, and how your bravery has made me brave. You have held my hand and helped me walk. You have touched the oxygen tube under my nose and told me, get well, Nanny. I'm so proud of you, the man you have become. You will have a great future because you are so talented with your art and your music. And one thing is for sure, you love your family and absolutely adore and cherish your mum. Your love for her is unconditional, no barriers, just love. We all love you dearly, Harvey, and are so proud of you. Me especially, I love you so much. To the Royal Brompton and Harefield Hospital, whose research department and transplant team have looked after me during this awful illness. Professor Phil Molyneux, Toby Mayer, his wife Maggie, and the research team, you really are exceptional people who have encouraged me to take chances and have kept me alive as long as possible, allowing me the opportunity to try research drugs. The transplant team has also been fantastic, especially transplant coordinator Debbie Burns, who encouraged me to get on the transplant list against all odds because of my age. My thanks to the consultants, Professor John Dunning and Dr. Martin Carby, Dr. Anna Reed, Dr. Vicky Gervasi, Dr. Kavita Dave, and all the wonderful nurses, and to the wonderful people who've become part of my transplant family by walking this road with me, namely to Jackie and Anita, who are still waiting for transplants. We've kept each other's spirits up, and I couldn't have done it without you. Thank you. Thank you. To St. Barnabas Hospice, thank you to all the amazing staff who have supported me with my end-of-life care. To my friends, you have all been there for me through thick and thin. These moments, along with those shared with my family, have made my life complete. I'd also like to say thank you to the donor's family, who in their hour of sorrow gave me the opportunity of life. When they let me have one of their relatives' lungs, you can't put a price on that. And I just want to say thank you again. Thank you. With love, Amy.
Foreword by Kate Price.
Whenever thinking of my mum, my mind fills me with music, laughter, and the image of her big green eyes. For as long as I can remember, we've been joined at the hip, and as a young girl, I recall her being so full of life. I watched her singing and dancing around to songs by Madonna, Luther Vandross, Alexander O'Neill, and George Benson. She played them on this little ghetto blaster, which was her pride and joy. For the rest of my life, I know a smile will spread across my face when I hear those tunes and picture her beautiful, happy face. When I sing and dance around with my own kids, I think about all that my mum has passed on to me and all that was passed on to her from my nan. In that sense, I think life is an incredible, complex, magical merry-go-round. Mum has always been the spirit and soul of everything, and I definitely get a lot of my personality from her. She is fiercely protective of her family and closest friends, and I used to cringe, actually I still do, at some of her opinions because she tells the honest truth and doesn't care what people think. Unfortunately, she's always right. What you see is what you get with my mum, and if she doesn't like you, she won't give you the time of day. Just so are some of my exes. She's definitely a force of nature. I know I get that from her. She's still the one person I look up to because I know I've learnt from her. Learnt from the best, Mother Price. We're very, very close, and she still tells me off to this day. When I'm around her, I revert to being a teenager. It's like Kevin and Perry go large. This is so unfair. It's often all I can say when she's having a go at me, which is quite often. All I can say when she's having a go at me, which is quite often. The truth is, I don't feel she's ever treated any of her children differently, even though I'm the one who gives her the most trouble because of the problem I have with choosing the right men. It's always men. I am touched that she has put her heart and soul into this book, allegedly for my own and our whole family. From the moment I stepped into the public arena, the media constructed an image of me which is not the whole truth. My mum is setting the record straight because she knows me better than any other person on this planet. In fact, she knows me better than I know myself. I can only thank her for all the love she has invested in this book, and I hope that her perspective on our family gives people a chance to form a more accurate picture and understand how certain patterns are formed. It's certainly been interesting and sometimes tough for me to contemplate. My mum has been alongside me at every single stage of my life, including the darkest moments imaginable. She certainly has evidence to back up what she says because she has seen my life unfold firsthand. She isn't a vindictive person and always wants the best for everyone. But if she's to stand up for the people she loves in order to protect them, she will. My career has been unusual and at times it has been exposed, my family to upset. For which I am really sorry, but I have never felt judged by my mum, and she has always been there for me, especially when Harvey was born. We found out a few years ago that her illness was terminal, and I've tried to get my head around it, but the time will come to say goodbye, and it definitely won't be easy. It's been very, very hard seeing her struggling to breathe and trying to talk, because she has always been and still is a warrior. She's starting to get very weak now, and I know that unless she gets a lung transplant, her death is just around the corner. I can't put into words how much I am going to miss my mum. My life will never be the same again. My life will definitely never be the same again when she's gone. So I'd like to tell her something now that I hope she's known all along. I love you so, so much. Kate.
Prologue. My name is Amy Price. In many ways, I'm just an ordinary mum, wife and granny. I adore dogs, horses and yoga. And I love to stroll by the sea close to my cosy little South Coast bungalow. But in all honesty, there's never been much of a chance to enjoy a completely normal life, because I also happen to be Katie Price's mum. A role that came with a lot more than I bargained for when her decision to become a topless model attracted the full attention of Britain's celebrity machine almost overnight. And now there is the terrible inconvenience of my mortality. It's a really hard thing to say out loud, but I'm dying, you see. Out of the blue, I was diagnosed with the incurable illness idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, IPF, in 2017, and given 5 years to live. It causes scarring to the lungs and makes it difficult to breathe, so in many ways it limits my everyday life, restricting my ability to do all the ordinary things I've always taken for granted, like cooking a meal, having a bath, and playing with my grandchildren. Nowadays, every day is like running a marathon, and my heart beats fast with exertion just walking back and forth to the bathroom. My lungs constantly require the portable oxygen tank that has of late become my trusted companion, trailing along behind me wherever I go. Socialising, travelling and even talking for long periods feel like mammoth tasks. And more recently, I have succumbed to using a wheelchair outside my home. I suppose it won't be long before I finally take up Kate's offer. She has always been known as Kate in our family, of a pink mobility scooter. But I haven't given up on walking just yet. Or life, for that matter. In many ways, edging closer to death has sharpened my mind, forcing me to look back over my life in an attempt to try to make sense of the forces that have shaped my family. Early on, I asked the incredible team taking care of me at Harefield Hospital to put my name on the lung transplant list, and it is in my nature to remain hopeful. But by the time you hear this, there is a strong chance I won't be here, and that's why this book had to happen, why I had to set the record straight once and for all. The world of fame needs heroes and villains to keep its audience entertained, and I am weary of seeing my daughter cast as the bad guy. For years I've looked on from the sidelines, but now it's time to reveal the real Kate, along with the impact her life in the limelight has had on our entire family. My greatest wish is that my daughter will one day find the peace she deserves, but I can't pretend I'm not scared of leaving her behind, terrified even. I've always been her rock, you see, the person who really knows what makes her tick. I'm the first person she calls when she's in trouble, which means my phone has been quite active over the past few decades. To the outside world, Kate is her own worst enemy, a grown woman who should know better than to set the scene again and again for her own demise through failed relationships with inappropriate men, a self-absorbed surgical quest for the perfect body, wild spending and even wilder partying. My daughter is seen by a large percentage of the British public as a free-falling fame junkie who gets the publicity she deserves, a reality TV caricature who has veered between the highs of national treasure and the lows of being compared to the serial killer Myra Hindley. Somewhere in this narrative, the essence of Kate has been lost, even to herself. But as her mum, I have never lost sight of my daughter's inner world. This book, which will serve as my last testament to her and her siblings and to my grandchildren when they're old enough to read it, is, of course, written with love and conveys the strong bond between us. But it is not a simplistic defence of her behaviour, because, frankly, her critics sometimes have a point. But what they don't know, what they've never known, is the truth. Through the column inches of the tabloid press and reality TV cameras, they have constructed an idea of my daughter based on what they have seen. But only me and her closest family understand why they have seen it. For years we have looked on, often powerlessly, as Kate's relationships have repeated toxic patterns of coercive control and domestic abuse.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.